iOS development, it's a pretty cool job. It can also be pretty tough to pull off these days. So I'm gonna give you a complete roadmap to follow in order to maximize your chances of becoming an iOS developer. You start by learning Swift. Big surprise, I know. Swift is the programming language that Apple created for iOS apps. Along with that, you also need to learn how to use the tools, which in our case is Xcode. It's the program that you actually do the coding on. To learn, just start with a beginner course. And to me, what course you choose, it doesn't really matter. Actually, it does matter, and here's why. Currently, there are two main ways to create an iOS app, or what we call frameworks. There's the UIKit framework, which has been around for a long time, and it's what makes up the vast majority of a code base for the vast majority of companies. And then there's the new kid on the block, which is a framework called SwiftUI. And the reality is that most companies in the US that are employing iOS developers right now have had their apps around long before SwiftUI even existed. And even several years from now, we'll still have the bulk of their code base in the UIKit framework. Meaning, if you have a strong working knowledge of UIKit, you become desirable to many, many more places than having a strong working knowledge of SwiftUI. Now, back to starting a course. Some people get so hung up on the whole, I must select the one true course and the rest will be terrible. No, I'm here to tell you that it doesn't matter which beginner course you go with, as long as it's UIKit. There's tons of great options like 100 Days of Swift from the Hacking with Swift website, Sean Allen has a great beginner course, Angela Yu from Udemy, Ray Wenderlich. All of these and many more are gonna give you a super solid foundation of the Swift programming language, and also how to use the Mac app called Xcode to actually put an application together and literally run it on your phone. It's the coolest thing in the world. I think early on, it's really helpful to keep things as simple as possible by sticking just with one course, rather than try and learn and juggle things from many different resources. Complexity is the enemy of execution. So keep things simple and you're less likely to get overwhelmed. This is also an important step so that you can start to test the waters and see if you actually like doing iOS development. Kind of makes sense, right? It's cool because all you need is a Mac in order to get a really accurate taste of what the career is like, which is something that you can't do in a lot of other careers, maybe like medicine or finance. Now, you've completed a course, you've gotten your feet wet. If you still like it, you now have to determine which path forward you want to go. There's still going to be a ton more that you need to learn to become an iOS developer, and a bootcamp or going full self-taught are two of the main paths to do that. And all I have to say there is just do whatever most aligns with your own life circumstances. But understand that your life circumstances are gonna be different than everybody else's life circumstances. And so don't trust anybody that says that this is the only way or that's the only way. There's just a lot of ways, okay? Bootcamps offer advantages such as structure, accountability, and access to instructors. But not everybody can afford the cost or the time commitment. In which case, going fully self-taught is completely viable. For most people, this path is going to be more challenging, but what's really cool is that all the information needed to learn iOS development is already out there, and mostly either for free or for a very reasonable price. And so the cost then just becomes your time and hard work, and likely sacrificing some of the time that you're putting towards things like hanging out with friends, hobbies, video games. And that's because it just takes so much freaking work no matter which path you go.
Okay, so I've learned the fundamentals of iOS development. Do I get a job now?
No, you don't. Not many other people are gonna tell you this, but through my own experience and from seeing so many others try and get their first iOS role, I can very confidently tell you that just learning iOS development isn't enough to get you a job anymore. I want you to hear that again. Learning iOS development or even graduating a bootcamp isn't enough to guarantee you a job in the field. That's because there's a ton of people who have learned it and who have the skill to be a good entry-level developer, but that are all going for a limited number of entry-level roles. So what gets you a job these days is knowing iOS development combined with separating yourself from a sea of other candidates. And that, my friends, is where the true challenge lies. But I'm gonna tell you some ways that you can do just that. Number one is to publish an app. Not a huge app, a small app, a simple app. This will speak volumes about you as a candidate and as an iOS developer, and what you're essentially doing is positioning yourselves above all the other candidates that don't have a published App Store app. Employers love it because it shows them that you have taken a project from start all the way to finish and that you understand how to submit apps and updates through App Store Connect, which is used by every single iPhone app. Sure, there might be a few outlier cases of people getting hired recently without an App Store app, but you're gonna have a really difficult time getting responses on your applications without one. So make this your number one priority above grinding on leak code, above learning Swift UI, and put the bulk of your time and effort into this very, very crucial step. Now, after this step, you wanna focus on becoming edgy. And by that, I mean, look for any possible edge that you can give yourself as a candidate, even if they seem small. Most other developers have bland or incomplete LinkedIn profiles and GitHub pages, so these are easy areas that you can, again, continue to elevate yourself above the competition that maybe has an App Store app like you do now. LinkedIn is where employers live and breathe, so it's critical to be where they're looking for employees and for your profile to be polished and complete. Yes, it's a small thing, but it's also low-hanging fruit, where you can just set it up once and essentially let it do its thing. And what that really does for you is it validates you as a person beyond just a resume. You have to understand that employers get tons of resumes. And so if they get two equally impressive resumes, but one of them has a really good looking LinkedIn page to back up and validate what's on that resume, then if I'm the employer, that person is already starting out in the lead. And now that brings us to GitHub, which is where you host code for all the projects that you have. So for a developer, it's basically your portfolio. And again, with the competition being so stiff, you can't afford to have an empty portfolio with no completed projects. Look, you wouldn't hire a photographer with no portfolio, right? Even if they could tell you every single thing about a camera and how it works and all the techniques of how to take the very best photos, you still want to see the photos. Now, the best way that I can think to have a really impressive looking GitHub page is by spending time crafting and putting together really impressive readmes for each of your best projects, which is kind of like a description or a landing page. Giving it screenshots or GIFs of the app in action, along with a description of the technologies that you used, is really reassuring to somebody viewing it, because if the readme is blank like this, then the assumption has to be that it's an incomplete project. This is one of those areas where you just have to be your own advocate. And so if you're spending 30 hours putting together the code for a project, then you can also spend 30 minutes putting together a really good readme. Again, most developers don't take the time to do this, which is actually really good for you because it means that it's an easy area where you can give yourself that edge. If you can do all those things really well, you're gonna put yourself in the upper half of all the people that are applying for these entry-level roles, which is exactly where you wanna be. So at this point, what you would start doing is apply like a madman or a madwoman. Now, of course, there is a strategic and a non-strategic way of doing this, but what I always recommend is prioritize connections and warm leads that you have over a cold application. One warm lead is probably going to be more effective than sending five cold applications. But if you're anything like I was, then at some point, warm leads and connections ran dry. And so at that point, just dump on the numbers of cold applications. Sure, each one may be a long shot, but most applications just require a resume and some basic information about you. And so if you can pump out 12 applications in an hour, to me, that's an hour well spent. Now, there are some people who preach, you should never do a cold application and only use networking to find a job. And it's like, sure, if we all lived in a perfect world, but the reality is that iOS development is such a narrow skill set that even a strong relational connection or recommendation can't fully compensate for that. So my take is just try and leverage both. I had the most success with Indeed and LinkedIn Jobs, so maybe start there. And don't be surprised if over half of the applications that you send, you never get a response from. That is totally normal. All right, hopefully that's enough to land you your first job, but I do have three quick bonus tips for anybody that is super serious about becoming an iOS developer. Number one is to leverage the community. iOS development has a weirdly supportive and welcoming community. This is great for motivation, encouragement, and for making connections. And to me, it makes development a lot more fun than if I'm always just doing it in a vacuum. Two of my favorite places for that are on Twitter and iOS Dev Happy Hour, which is a monthly meetup with developers from all over the world and all different skill levels, and it's always a good time. Number two is to consider a part-time internship. During my job search, the only feedback that I was ever given was just that they went with somebody who had more experience. So doing an internship can be a really effective way to appear like you have something that's really close to real job experience. I know a lot of people who did this, myself included, and when we did, we immediately started to get more traction on our resumes because employers are just biased towards people with experience. And the final bonus tip is to just accept that the road is likely going to be a long one. Something like 6 months of intense learning and then another 6 to 12 months of applying and more learning. My take on this is probably a bit more blunt because I've seen so many smart and hardworking people really struggle to overcome the bias that employers have against them as people without prior job experience. However, it absolutely can be done, 100%. And it's such a fun and rewarding career. And so I believe in you, but I'd rather show you the battle scars and then give you the tools and the strategies to be successful than just get up here and tell you that it's gonna be really easy and straightforward, because it is neither of those things. It's a really high barrier to entry, but the amazing thing is that once you finally break in and get that first developer job,
it's done.
Yes, Mr. Frodo. It's over now.
I'm serious, once you do that, you can be so selective in all future roles because there is so much demand for mid-level developers who have job experience. And so that bias that employers have towards those people now actually starts to work in your favor, regardless of if that's fair or not. I have videos going deeper into a lot of these topics, so check out the playlist in the description to hit some of those. And if you took something from this video, it would mean a lot to me if you show your support by hitting the like button or sharing the video. Thanks as always for stopping by, and grind on. Thank you.